Hello. Can you hear me? So, Mohammed, I had sent the article on Enkvin's hill climbing with Min Conflict's heuristic on ResearchGate. Did you receive the full text? So you can share it on the group also, because why I didn't share it publicly, I realized that in the file, because I have used some figures from the textbook and I have given due credit there, but I have not asked the authors explicitly. So it cannot be a publication, it can be still shared among us, or even on the course page I can share it. But with a limited purpose, that it is only meant for our course, it is meant for our academic purpose. It must not be treated as a research paper. So you can share it on our WhatsApp group so that everyone else also can see. So I'm now showing the solution to the regular exam that just was over last weekend, and also we'll start on the chapter on logical agents, but let us look at the solution once. So the first question, actually there is a ready answer in the textbook itself, but I have given an answer here which is interpreting the same in linear argument. So first of all, we have to recognize that the uniform cost and A star are the same, except that in A star search in general, the heuristic function H will not be zero uniformly, whereas in the uniform cost search it is zero. And the zero function, it will not overestimate the path cost. That means uniform cost search is A star search with admissible heuristic, which is uniformly zero. Admissible because it will never overestimate. But the only thing is that it will be the least efficient among all the heuristics possible. That's sure, because it will take the maximum time required by any A star implementation for that problem. But once we prove it for any one of them, it will be enough for the other, because what we need is only when a node brought into the fringe, or when it is taken for expansion, when it is estimated for optimality as a goal node. So that is my argument here. So otherwise, we had seen already in the proof of optimality of A star search when H is admissible, when the heuristic function H is admissible. We have seen this argument completely. There is no difference. The recognition that uniform cost search also the same argument applies is the only additional part here. Okay, 20 questions over else. So 20 questions if you have played the game. In fact, when I asked this question, this came to me because of a 10-year-old kid who was with our group in a recent trip in during vacation, winter break. Because during the journey, the only pastime that adults and the kid could share without getting either one of us getting bored was this 20 questions. So one team fixes some name of a person or of a place. Usually, that it has to be famous. It has to be. You should be sure that both the parties know the name. They should be knowing the name. That you are expected to know the name because it is a famous name. And then the other party starts asking questions. They can start something like, "Okay, is it in India or abroad?" Is it a person or a place? Then if a person, then is it male or female? Alive or dead? All those things, and then if dead, then which period of history it belongs to, the name belongs to, and all that. So gradually you have to guess what is the name. And if you do it within 20 questions, then you have won the game. If you cannot do that, then the party which fixed the name has won that round of the game. That is the main 20 questions game. So I just turned it into a simple game on guessing, that is bracketing basically a real number by integers. Simple. Okay, and it's basically it's going as a binary search. So the game by itself is not anything much. It's only the modeling part, formal modeling part. So the answers here are about the branching and utility function first. So the possible questions are 2k, because there are k values we know of integers in which within which all this has to fit. So 2k questions are possible, and so for the first question there are 2k possibilities, and then gradually once we have asked one question, then the possibilities will progressively reduce in it at each level. And we can know that since we cannot ask more than 20 questions, there will be a certain limit to that. So, and the utility function also will not be monotonic in any path, in any direction. This is also very important. The only thing, the only change in the utility values other than just winning or losing the game is that there is a penalty, there is a cost to asking questions. Okay, this game is deterministic in the absolute sense, because once k is fixed, then the questions are all that is for all possible numbers and all possible scenarios in the game, there will be a definite outcome of each question, and queries and answers both will be known to both the players, so it is a perfect information. The unknown is to be discovered anyway, so that is not about imperfect information, because the game is about discovering that. Okay, and particularly what Z is will not affect the decisions and interaction between the players. So alpha beta pruning, especially when we have a perfect deterministic and game of perfect information in which the game tree is perfectly finite, that is we exactly know how many nodes will be there in it, then and you see even though Z itself is uncountable, that is the possibilities for Z are uncountable, the outcomes of the game are not uncountable, they are fixed, they are in fact finite. That is where basically the ordering comes in, and once we can order, we can have pruning, we can guarantee optimality. So the main lesson about this, actually it is not much about the algorithms, it's about only modeling, recognizing that when we reduce questions over uncountable sets to discrete possibilities, then everything becomes amenable to very, very simple computation. That's the main lesson about this. Nothing much in it. And I will remind you again when we had discussed this earlier, and later on also this idea will recur again. That is, in AI, in fact, this is what we want to do. And it's only a coincidence that only recently this event of Boeing 737 planes crashing, and then all the 737 MAX planes all over the world are grounded now. About 350 planes are grounded until this technological conundrum is resolved. It's a very relevant question. It pertains to automation in hybrid systems in which the machines, the objects, the environment all behave and evolve in continuous quantities. That is, it cannot be discretized, cannot be episodic also. It happens in a continuous manner. It's a physical world. But your controls, your automation systems are based on discrete decisions taken at discrete time intervals. And then there are humans who are also operating, so they will make both. They will make discrete decisions when, for example, they see an alarm, they see a light glowing, they see an alert message, or they see that the autopilot is making certain decision. That is a discrete part. But they also have continuous senses of their own. They can see that the aircraft is taking off, then its height is increasing or decreasing, or whether it is within safe limits or not, and all that. So that sense also is working with the pilots. The experienced pilots will have their own analog senses as well. When that happens, and when a man-machine system, interactive man-machine system is there, a lot of complexities arise in that. And currently the technology world is debating all that. I can share the latest Bloomberg report on this also, because it also recalls earlier such incidents and the lessons drawn from it. And the main crux of it is that is their focus now is on how such systems are documented, the manuals, the representation of the processes that the autopilot, the automated systems are carrying out, the reasoning rationale behind them, and what then humans should interpret and then decide and act upon that in different situations. This is the most crucial factor everyone is agreeing upon, that if there is anything lacking in that, then pilots can interpret the machine's behavior in inconsistent ways, and that can lead to more complexities and unstable decisions, or rather I will say contradictory decisions in rapid succession by the pilots, and the machine also responding to that in its own way, because the machine also is programmed to avoid certain contradictory actions or decisions. And it's so there are interlocks in its behavior, right? That is, for example, you cannot simultaneously start the process that raises the nose and at the same time prepares for landing, because for landing you have to take the nose down. So there will be all such interlocks also in place, and if the pilots are also panicking and making rapid decisions which can go contradictory within a span of seconds, then you can imagine that the system is never designed or planned for such a situation, and pilots are also not trained for such situation. This is the consensus building up now, that this is what is happening, that when we have man-machine systems and we have more and more automation in the aircraft, this is what is happening. Yeah, there was a discussion which compared the design of an intelligent agent and a control system. How are they different? Can we say a rule-based intelligent agent is similar to control system? You are right there, Nasir. You are almost, we can say that a purely rule-based intelligent agent is similar to a control system. And what you mean by rule-based is basically like a reflex agent, right? Reflex agent with fixed rules or a table of a perception action pair, right? Rule based is that. Is that right? What do you mean? Yeah, direct mapping. Yeah. So that is more akin to a control system, and even that control system will not be exactly an analog control system in which, so for example, a servo motor is an analog control system in which there are no discrete decisions made, but continuous signals are driving. The error signal, the difference between the set point, the desired set point, and the actual reading currently, that difference signal will continuously drive the quantities which will govern the servo motor's behavior. So aircrafts typically will have more of such servo controls, analog controls, because that is how engines, mechanical engines will operate. But the pilots or the autopilot also will control these control systems. That is, control means they will tune, they will parameterize, they will set the different points through digital controls. So that is the tricky part. That is the part where the complexity is getting out of hand. And unless this is now documented well, unless it is also given to the pilots, they are trained enough, and they are trained not only in a mechanical fashion, they are trained not as intelligent agents but as human agents who can also interpret situations which are not documented in that. But at the same time, what is documented is the complete range of possibilities of the machine itself. Then these complexities can be handled. And there is a very, very deep, very, very important lesson here. And in the coming days, I hope to see more discussion, more healthy discussion on this, because AI had become all the rage recently in the last couple of years. And such happenings can suddenly also become, if some journalist makes again some pithy, catchy slogan about this crash, then suddenly it can also happen that people will completely lose confidence in AI. Now, the point that is getting missed in all this is that AI is as good as its implementation, and implementation includes the deployment by the people who are operating those things. It cannot be more than that. So complete automation, even Google's car will have some caveats. So more on that as we again come across machine learning and the more advanced and soft computing stuff. Okay, now in the test, the PEAS modeling question was very simple. So the solution is here, and anyway, since it is going to be on the course page, I will not dwell on this. So I can skip this part and we can go to the chapter 7. If k is not fixed, then of course the possible outcomes will still be finite for each k, but we cannot plan the algorithm beforehand. That is, alpha beta pruning also will take different forms in. Yeah, it will be on the LMS portal, yes. In fact, since I have showed it here, then the assistant here will upload with the slides. Player can choose the same moves again, but then that is not exactly how optimal game playing will happen, right? If k is not fixed and k is not known, then yeah, it doesn't seem deterministic. Yes, right. In fact, it is undecidable then. We are not sure whether for all z, we can in fact arrive at an answer in 20 questions. If k is not fixed. Well, there are no exact right or exact wrong answers, that's why. So for PAS, there is a more or less standard answer, the third question. The first question is anyway standard answer. Standard means you can write it in a little different language, but the main crux of the argument is the same. And it's the same as the proof of optimality of A star when H is admissible. So that is standard, but Q2 is an open-ended question, and in fact that is how I wanted it. I want to see how you approach such questions, and you will see that I have given that instruction to the TAs for the first question. Second question, I have not given that instruction, but this is how I tell the TAs basically. Okay. So let us now turn to the usual course, because there is a long gap. Let us have some recap. And so I want to go as soon as possible to the soft computing part. So we'll turn towards probability handling uncertainty basically, and then we'll go to statistical learning and machine learning and all the different learning paradigms as soon as possible. Yes, correction. I am saying that the approach to the answer is more important than the answer itself. Okay, so I am starting the chapter on logical agents. Now I cannot recall how far we have discussed this earlier, but I will quickly start with the basics, because this chapter is important, but at the same time by itself logic and then later on inductive logic learning can be a course that can be a full semester course. So the more we discuss it, there will be more even to discuss. And also for another reason, that all the algorithms that handle logic, logical arguments, proofs, they ultimately fail means they are completely inefficient against many of the real life situations, and we cannot ever hope to have exact answer. Of course, we don't have a proof yet, but there is overwhelmingly our computer science researchers so far believe that no, we cannot have guaranteed and efficient solutions to these problems. Therefore, we will have to find newer and newer heuristics, and we also have to do knowledge engineering. Basically, we have to analyze the situations beforehand, so that our algorithms also can work efficiently and at the same time with all the safety guarantees. Therefore, these two chapters, that is 7, 8, 9, the module on logic, they are important, and at the same time they are fathomless. That is, there are a lot of things there in them. So we can only skim over the surface. We cannot hope to get deeper within the given limited time span we can give to. Therefore, I will introduce you to all the important points, and then whoever wants to explore more, I will give you all the pointers and go towards uncertainty. So today and tomorrow I want to complete this model. So we are these three chapters 7, 8, 9, we are going to look at agents equipped with knowledge in the form of logical propositions and relations between them. So we imagine this agent as having two main components. They are independent in many ways, the two components. So there is a knowledge base which is specific to the application domain, and there is an inference engine which has algorithms, which has basically ways of making inference from the known facts from the domain specific content in the knowledge base, and certain rules of how that inference can be made consistently and as much as possible efficiently. And this doesn't depend on the domain, on the application, on the content of the knowledge base. It doesn't depend on that. It only depends on a form of reasoning, and that's why we call this formal logic. That is, we have to have a formal language to represent all the facts in the application domain. And once that formal specification, formal representation is there, then the inference engine can work without really worrying about whether we are talking of biology or we are talking of aircraft flying. it doesn't matter then. So that is the main strength or attraction of logical inference, that once we turn things into symbolic formal language, then everything follows without regard to what exactly we are talking about. So now we can have the view or the design analyzed at the knowledge level, that is the content, and the content in again in the form of the formal relations between the content, different components of the content. Or we can also look at the implementation part, in which how the representation is actually stored in computer's memory, and algorithms which are manipulating those data structures. So these are the two ways in which such agents are viewed. Mostly the domain experts will look at the agent at the knowledge level, and then engineers like us, we are going to look at the implementation level. So well, this slide is in fact just a filler, because it gives just one formal representation to what we have been saying, that percepts are turned into some symbolic yes no type fact sequences, and then once they are turned into that, then the knowledge base is updated with that using the tell function. The ask function will get an action out of the knowledge base and the particular query formed again in the same formal language, and the knowledge base is again told that the action emanating out of that is the decision basically for the knowledge base. It is again put in a formal symbolic language in the knowledge base. And this will also update the representation of the world, because the representation of the world itself is that formal knowledge base. So we have a toy example again. Programming language is a formal language, no doubt, but the compiler is not an agent that maps it to any domain content. It turns it into another formal language, because the assembly language, the machine language itself is also a formal language. So there this analogy doesn't work. So let us look at this Wumpus world. This is a toy world again, and this is like a computer video game. So the agent is basically moving through a grid. That is, agent can visit one cell at a time, and the agent can move between cells that are sharing a wall. That means the agent cannot go diagonally. The agent can go horizontally, vertically, in any direction. And this grid, that is the cells in this grid, will also have different features. So there are pits. There is a Wumpus, which is a daemon, which will kill the agent whenever the agent enters the cell in which the Wumpus is. And the other features are that wherever there are pits, then the adjacent cells, not diagonally neighboring, but horizontally and vertically neighboring cells, will have breathes. So the agent can feel that breathe. So that is one of the percepts. And similarly, Wumpus will give a stench out into the adjacent cells horizontally and vertically. So the agent again can smell that and conclude that the Wumpus is somewhere nearby. And the Wumpus doesn't move. The Wumpus doesn't do anything actively. When the agent enters the Wumpus cell, then the agent gets killed. That's it. And that is also deterministic. So it is called a daemon and all that, but it doesn't have, it's like a pit again. So whenever the agent falls in a pit, also agent gets killed. Whenever the agent falls in the lap, on the lap of the Wumpus, it gets killed. That's it. There is one more feature to it, that the agent can shoot an arrow, and if the arrow is shot in the direction where Wumpus is, then the Wumpus definitely gets killed. That's certain. And optionally, the agent, the Wumpus can give a shriek that the agent can hear, so another percept that the agent knows that the Wumpus has been hit and dead. But that is not very important, that is not necessary. And another feature of this Wumpus world is one sale will be having gold, and the agent will again know when the agent enters the sale where the gold is, because the gold glitters. So the goal is to get that gold, because then in the performance measure, agent gets 1,000 points more. Okay, now so you can see this game is a typical video game for kids, and now we want to see how a logical agent can play this game. So well, I will not dwell on this Wumpus world characterization because it is very obvious. It is not observable in the sense that all the cells of the grid are not seen. We can see them when they are depicted on the slide, but the agent cannot see all of them at once. Agent will explore by local movement and local perception. Deterministic, yes, exactly what happens is deterministically determined. Episodic, no, because the Wumpus doesn't make any more. There are no other agents also. So the agent can decide actions, and those actions can also be just repetitive actions without any new effect. The agent can decide, for example, to go back and forth in two cells which are known to be safe, while the agent is calculating. That's possible. So there is no episodic requirement. Like chess, for example, you cannot do that. You have to make the next move, and the game will always progress in some direction. You cannot keep, for example, repeating things, and if you repeat thrice, then the game will be decided as a draw. So that doesn't happen here. So this is not episodic. It is static, yes, because Wumpus also doesn't move, pits don't move. Okay, it is discrete, yes, because the cells are completely discretized. This is even less than Pac-Man, because Pac-Man is not exactly discretized, right? It keeps moving in some kind of a continuous line, but yeah, it is something like Pac-Man, and it is a single agent. The Wumpus is not an agent, remember, it's just like a pit. So our logical agent is the agent, is the only agent in this environment. So okay, so initially the agent starts at the bottom left corner, and of course that bottom left corner is safe, otherwise the game doesn't start at all. The agent gets killed, then the game doesn't start. So bottom corner is safe, and there is no sensory perception of breeze or of the stench of the Wumpus. So that given, so sitting in the bottom left corner, the agent can decide that both the adjacent squares to that are safe, because there is no breeze, there is no stench. That means there is no pit, there is no Wumpus nearby. So the agent can decide to explore any one of the directions. So suppose it goes to the sail above it. Now it is sensing a breeze. Okay, the square is definitely safe, but one of the adjacent squares has a pit. Adjacent squares to the one above the bottom left corner. So there will be a question about that. Right, is there a pit? Okay, we can number the cells like row and column, so we can see that first column third row and second column second row. These are the questions, whether there is a pit, and which situations will actually give you breeze in first column second row. So that definitely will be like four possibilities. There can be pits in both the squares in which the question mark is put, or any one of them. So three possibilities, not four, sorry. The fourth possibility that there is no pit in any one of them is not now plausible. It is not consistent with the breeze that we are sensing in the first column, second row. So there will be three possibilities in which we can get a breeze in this, right? So okay, now the agent can come back to the bottom left corner and go again towards right. Now here, the agent is getting a stench and no breeze. So we can now know that 2, 2, there is no pit. And we can also say that in 2, 2, that is second column, second row, there is no vampus as well. Why? Because we had gone to the earlier square, which was in second row, first column. There was no stench there and there was breeze there. That means now in 2, 2, there cannot be vampus definitely. There was no stench in the cell adjacent to it. So now we know that a vampus will be on the right of the current position of the agent. And above the current position of the agent, there is neither pit nor vampus. It is a safe square. Right? So we can see the conclusions now drawn, right? We have exactly identified where the pit is, which we earlier had not known exactly, and we also now know that there is a vampus next to the current position of the agent. Can you see that all these conclusions that we are drawing are basically following a logical reasoning method? We are clearly following a logical reasoning method, and now we want to formalize this. Like Minesweeper, yes, it's more like Minesweeper. No, we know the state of the cells of the cells that we have visited so far, and also the the three cells that are now shown. One cell has a pit, which is first column, third row. Then second column, second row is now shown as safe, and third column, first row is shown as having vampus. So these are the three cells we haven't visited, but we know about them now. So we know about all the cells we have visited, and we also know by inference, by logical inference, because the rules of the game are deterministic and logical. By logical inference, we can know about those cells also that are adjacent but not visited by us, right? So we know a lot now, and it's not only the state of the current cell. But the point is that this is a sequential discovery process which proceeds only by local progress. We know locally, we cannot know everything at once. Well, at the end of the game, perhaps we will have known all the cells. We will have known everything about this environment. That's possible at the end of the game. But throughout, this is not an environment which is of perfect information, because we have only partial information incrementally improving. So it is not any one of the two extremes. So one extreme is what Nasir is asking, that we only know the state of the current cell. That is not true. We know more. But we know more because partially we start discovering more and more incrementally. So we don't also know everything at any point except at the end. So we can build the tree by either exploration as well as logical inference. Yeah, so for us, exploration now, because our rules are so logical, that our exploration itself is logical inference in a sense, right? We can proceed in a sequential manner. The percept part is there, of course. That exploration has percept part. Whenever we reach a cell, we'll get the breeze or the stench or the glitter or none of them. How the 2C star 2R from P? So well, we had seen breeze in first column, second row, right? We had seen breeze in first column, second row. Then we came down and again went towards right. So now second column, first row. We don't have breeze. In second column, first row, we have stench. S is shown, but B is not shown. Right? So we have stench. That means there cannot be a pit in 2, 2, that is second column, second row. Why? Because if there had been a pit there, then there would be breeze also in the square where the agent is now. right? There should be breeze in second column, first row, right? So therefore 2-2 has to be safe. And of course 2-2 also doesn't have wumpers. Why? Because there was no stench in first column, second row. There was no stench. So wumpers also is not there in 2-2. So we know for sure that 2-2 is completely safe. No wumpers, no pit. Right? Okay. So we can proceed. So now let us go ahead. Now because we know 2-2 is safe, we go into that. Now we know that there is no breeze, no stench there. That will make us even bolder. Now we know more about two more cells, because there is no breeze, there is no stench. Two more cells are okay. They are safe. We can explore more now, right? Without risking, we can explore more. Now, as soon as we go into the cell right of the current position, we get breeze, we get glitter, we get stench. Stench obvious because the wumpus is down there, right, adjacent to it. Glitter is there, that means gold is there. Now, this is in a sense gold. We have gold. Get the 1000 points that we get when we grab gold. So grab it. So that is done. Okay, this is how the game will proceed. Now formalization, how to make this into a formal language in a knowledge base. Okay, so there are some tight spots. So if we get breeze in both the squares adjacent to the bottom left corner, you see the situation on the top in this slide. So that means there can be pit in 2-2 as well, right? We don't know for sure. Now suppose that we have uniformly distributed pits, then well, point it is 6. Where is point 86 coming from? Okay, perhaps they took the total number of squares earlier as usual. Okay, so with some calculation, they decide that each square which has a question mark here can have probability of having the pit at 0.86. With this big probability, we are not safe going anywhere, because all the three squares where we can go can be risky, can have a pit. So the problem with modeling this as search, as simple state space search, is that there was only one goal node or goal test, and that goal test was applicable directly by description of the state. Whereas here, unless we reach a cell, we will not know whether it has that gold or not. And before that, we have to see that the square that we enter must be safe. It must not have a pit or the wumpers. So the way we are seeking a path, and an optimal path at that, in the state space search, that is not what we are looking at here. The difference also is that if there we make a suboptimal decision, we don't lose life. The agent doesn't get killed. Whereas here, a suboptimal decision actually means life and death. So in this sense, it is much different from all the state space search problems we have seen. Okay. If we get smell in 1-1, then we cannot move safely, but there is one option. So you shoot an arrow in any one of the two directions available. So in that direction, even if wumpus was there, the wumpus is dead, so it is safe. And if wumpus had not been there in the originally in the original configuration, then anyway we wasted an arrow, all right, but we we know that the direction is safe anyway. So we can shoot an arrow in one direction and move in that direction, knowing that now it is safe, whatever had been the situation with the Wampus earlier. And then in other cells, we will get corresponding corresponding stains if the Wampus is still alive in the other direction. So that also we will come to know. So we can have some kind of rescue, some escape in this situation as well, in the lower part of this slide. Okay, now in general, how formalization happens. So we will have a formal grammar to sentences and how to interpret them also. How to interpret means how we can assign real world facts to the formal representation of the sentences or statements. There are some examples shown here from arithmetic and algebra. So once we have that formal language representation, then inference will proceed through certain concepts. So now I think we should take a break, a short break of 5 minutes, and then again we start on these concepts, because now we will be entering the formal domain. We will forget about concrete examples like Wampus for some time. Again, we will revisit them, applying all these concepts to the Wampus world very soon. So let us take a 5-minute break, and again we turn to this.